Yeah. Draft day, Johnny Manziel. 5 years later, how am I the man still? Draft day, A. Wiggins. That other side, we stay winning. Oh man, you know I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. Yeah. Suits and ties yelling out, pay the guys, man, I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. You know I had to do it for you. Oh man, oh man, oh man, man, you know I had.
Welcome back to the Racial Draft Podcast, where we change the complexion of the comic book universe, one draft pick at a time. I am your host, Michael Ford, joined by the defending, returning champion for now.
for now.
Carlos Freitas. Carlos, how's it going?
It's going all right. Getting over a cold. I didn't think I was going to be able to record this episode because I was losing my voice earlier this week. So this is... Yeah, I was sounding real Vin Diesel-y. Okay. Like, it was about her. I was like, uh-oh.
Family.
Yeah.
Well, it is.
A lot of the time.
It is MOK weekend, and where MOK wanted people to be judged not by the color of their skin, but by the content of their character. We here at the Racial Draft judge people by both the color of their skin and the content of their characters. And we will do so in a moment. But first, we'll talk about a little bit of nerd news. It was a pretty light week of nerd news. There was a little bit of casting for Agatha, Coven of Chaos. Actually, less casting and more production information. We found out the directors for their episodes. Let me get to that right now. Ganja Montero. Jack Schaefer is going to be the head writer and executive producer. She's also going to be directing multiple episodes.
Jack Schaefer was WandaVision?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So, you know, very much in that spin-off tree element. A lot of cool cast members. We didn't talk about this on the podcast, or maybe we talked about it briefly. Legendary Patti LuPone is part of this cast. Additional legend Aubrey Plaza is going to be part of this cast. Joe Locke from Heartstopper, which I have not seen. Emma Caulfield will be reprising her role from WandaVision, as will be Deborah Jo Rupp, which is, you know, I wonder, will Westview play a major role in this show? It does kind of feel like that's what's going to happen.
I think that I've heard more than those two, multiple citizens of Westview will be back. The mailman and the guy who worked with Vision at the nondescript business,
place
that made reports. Yeah.
Yeah. It's like, these reports don't actually say anything.
Right. Yeah. all the people that we thought were either Mephisto or, who else did we think were the names that were out there for characters we thought, like, oh, I think this person is.
Or a Skrull. We thought they were either
Skrull. We definitely thought there were some Skrulls. It's my brain is like fried. The guy who's going to be the villain in Guardians 3, the character.
High Evolutionary.
There were people, remember, who thought that the one black guy on
WandaVision was like, his name was Herbert.
Right, exactly. Herbert. Yeah. He must be the High Evolutionary.
Like, yeah, we were deep in our bag.
And we didn't know how to connect imaginary dots. Well, and also because they kept throwing us Easter eggs and like the jingly opening themes or whatever. Like, oh, that's how we got to watch this show. We're watching this show with Easter eggs in mind.
Which again, Easter eggs are cool, but we were always trying to like get... We were attacking it from like a Lost perspective. We thought we were watching Lost when we were watching Fringe.
Now to be fair, Loki did the same thing leading to Kang. And we're like, well, but that they're not gonna show Kang.
Yeah, it's like clearly after WandaVision, we're not gonna fall on that banana in the tailpipe. There's all these Kang Easter eggs, but no.
There's no way.
And yeah, we had severely underrated the extent to which they could afford Jonathan Majors.
Right.
Like, we were like, Jonathan Majors is a big deal. Not so much. We're joined by Jared. Jared, we're still in the introduction phase of our podcast. So, Jared, how's it going? We're talking about our nerd news. We're talking about the Agatha Coven of Chaos, and you know, just the little bit of director news alongside just overall discussions about what we think about the show overall.
Right. Well, hello. I'm very happy to be here. Guys, definitely got a late start here, but I'm glad I could make it. I could throw in my two cents on the Agatha.
Yeah,
you'd like.
Go for it.
This show is easily like this. I feel like this was a show that when it was announced, I couldn't have cared less. I loved Catherine Hahn in the show, but by the end of WandaVision, Agatha's place seemed so murky to me. I loved the buildup of the mystery, but it really seemed like that the writers of the show didn't really know what to do with Agatha by the end.
Okay, see that.
So now having a show about Agatha, especially where we left off with her, and you know, I believe she is the first Marvel character to get an MCU project to not have previously had their own comic book. I'm fairly certain that's true.
No one else rings a bell, so yeah, you might be right.
Yes.
So I really just could not get myself to care about this show. And then they started announcing the cast.
Did you see the little rumor about, I don't know if it's a rumor, but little soundbite from a teaser from Catherine Hahn where she's like, yeah, there might be a little bit of singing.
Yeah, there might be a song or two or something like that.
Yeah, they're going full musical, guys. We're gonna love it.
I don't know if you guys know, I'm a musical theater major in college.
Oh, I didn't know that. That's amazing. That. Yeah.
So to have Patti LuPone in MCU show, it's like worlds are colliding here. So yeah, I am getting excited for the show. And now when you announce Jack Schaefer, who you know, has been very involved with WandaVision, seemingly is building out this corner of the MCU and now is directing episodes of the show, as well as the director from Wednesday, which is a show that I thought was good and totally fits the vibe with what it seemed like.
No spoilers, I'm still working through Wednesday.
Oh yeah, no. Okay. it just seems very promising. So I don't, like, they're going to make me care about this show.
They are going to make you care about the show for sure. And, you know, this is one of the cool things about the MCU when it's working, I suppose, is, you know, they're not just constrained by characters that have that are a big deal in the books. If someone hits, if an actor can breathe life into a character that's not that big of a deal in the comics and give us an angle to make us care about the character more, that just makes that character more valuable in other media. You know, we've seen it a little bit where Agatha's profile has been raised in the comics. I think they de-aged her in the Midnight Suns book. I think, you know, Agatha's playing some role in the Midnight Suns video game. You know, she's all of a sudden Agatha Harkness, who would have been way, way, way down on anyone's list of Marvel characters that people would know about, is rising in the ranks.
Agatha Harkness is also one of the more infamous cards in Marvel Snap.
If you have Snap correspondent, Carlos?
Yeah, if you have Agatha Harkness in your Marvel Snap deck, which I don't, to this day, I don't really understand why you would, but she's worth a lot. However, she takes over your hand and plays for you, and she's awful. Like she plays randomly. She just plays randomly. The kicker being if at any point, because every turn is like based on how much you get a budget for every turn. Mm-hmm. If at any point there was some kind of buff or power up that allowed her to afford to play herself, she will, and then you get control back. But if not, she's always the turn six and she's worth like 15 power, which is massive. But it's like she's so people, even if you didn't watch WandaVision and you play Marvel Snap, you're like, I know Agatha Harkness. That's that hoe that's always taking over my deck.
Look at this. Look at this. So we're going to stay in the Marvel reign, sort of Marvel realm a little bit, but not exactly. I still haven't seen RRR. I know I feel bad. I just couldn't find the time to commit to the extravaganza.
Yeah.
But NTR Jr., one of the stars from RRR, was asked over the last week whether he would like to do a Marvel movie. And he's like, hell yeah, I like money.
I feel like, okay, there's asking, you know, prestige directors what they think of comic book films and asking actors if they want to be in movies that will get them crazy paid for a decade, I think are the two dumbest questions to ask, like red carpet or whatever. Would you ever want to be in a Marvel movie? Like, it is so rare that you're gonna be like, fuck no. Like, you know, you're not gonna, like, you're really not gonna get that.
No, I totally agree with, like, I want to be in a Marvel movie, yet you don't see that making like a Deadline headline, you know?
Right.
Well, my thing is that I don't have a problem with them asking the question. I have a problem with that turning into a whole article, the premise or an article. Because if the article, if the article is, there's a follow-up question, which character would you like to play?
Yes.
And then they say, oh, I don't know. I mean, I've been honestly been a fan of character X. Now there's a little bit of meat on that bone. Now you can be like, oh, this character has not been yet been cast. And this actor who's of some renown says that they would like to play this character. Speculation abound.
Every agency in Hollywood should have at least one employee whose job it is to fan cast their clients and be like, if someone asks you, you say you want to be this character. Because, you know, like that would just make sense.
The internet would have a lot of fun with that. Like the
internet would go nuts.
Yeah. Next call you make is to Boss Logic, you know, because Boss Logic will in 10 minutes
do
a Photoshop of you in that costume.
Right. It's like Lin-Manuel Miranda is like, I always wanted to be Carnage. Okay, my guy, that's not happening. First of all, that was never going to happen for
did
you.
Did he say that?
Yes, he did. He loves Carnage. But he's like, it was never going to happen for you, first of all. And also, like, it's already been cast. When you answered the question, there was already a Carnage
movie in the works. Yeah,
so like, but if you know, if he was to say I always wanted to play
the Hypno Hustler, especially because like especially because it's Sony, like they probably will make that phone call if he says that he wants to play obscure Spider-Man Land character with a musical background.
Right.
Like,
right. If he was just like, you know, I've always wanted to play the guy that I drafted him to be last year, Multiple Man. I've always wanted to play Multiple Man. I guarantee you, Kevin Feige would be like, dude, Lin-Manuel Miranda wants to play Multiple Man. We didn't even have plans for Multiple Man, but we're going to throw him into something now. And every agency in Hollywood should have at least one employee whose job it is to be like, this is the character you say you want to be, you know?
Yes. And then just stay on message.
Yeah, again, just have me do it. It's all I do in this draft.
Yeah, but you're only doing it for the Jewish characters. It's a little harder because I'm going to put you on the, this, you know, the South Asian delegation should probably do this. But NTR Jr. says that he wants to play someone in the MCU. And, you know, wouldn't you know it, there aren't too many South Asian characters to choose from. So,
right.
Wouldn't be right if I, you know, boxed him in there.
Yeah, but he said, listen, he's already getting cut is what he says. So he's just waiting. He's just waiting for the Marvel brand HGH and he can really show us what's what. So, but I agree. I think that's a tremendous idea. Whatever agency you are, whether it's Endeavor, whether it's WGA? No, that's the Writers Guild.
That's the Writers Guild.
WWE WME? No, that's
WME.
WME. There we go. WME. Yeah. Whatever.
We're Hollywood insiders, guys.
Exactly. Subscribe to our podcast. But yeah, like for sure, you should have at least three fan casts in mind, and then that way, like, if one gets announced, then you
for sure
move on to the next one.
Yes.
Have your people just putting out that energy on social media.
Yeah. Yeah, like if Timothy Chalamet's people are like, say you want to be, you know, whatever, Batman Beyond or something like that, the internet would go nuts if he said, I always wanted to play Batman Beyond.
Yeah, exactly. Or stay tuned later.
Perfection.
But yeah, I mean, so we'll leave it to the listeners. If you'd like to fan cast NTR Jr. as one of the drafted characters for the South Asian delegation, let us know. But moving on from the Marvel land to I don't know, what do you want to call this, the Ezraverse? Let's call it the Ezraverse. from the MCU to the Ezraverse, it seems that our favorite protagonist, Ezra Miller, has successfully skated, so to speak, you know, and that's not just talking about how Barry Allen navigates the Speed Force. We're talking about the long armor of the law. Yes, there was a plea deal, and the long national nightmare that is Ezra Miller has perhaps come to an end. Ezra will pay a fine.
$500.
$500. And 1 year of probation, and does not look like there are any pending cases for our favorite non-binary comic book antagonist. So all systems are a go for the Flash and all of the shenanigans that are going to be tied to that movie. And who knows, maybe this will be the last time that we talk about Ezra and crime on this podcast.
If I never talk about Ezra Miller ever again, it'll be too soon.
I mean, the movie will come out, like David Zaslav is going to personally deliver that movie to the movie theater. It is his dying wish. He himself will die and be like, but The Flash is still coming out, as for sure. So, you know.
You guys, I mean this sincerely. I am more intrigued by The Flash, the movie, than anything else coming out this year. Like, it is, I really just need to know, what is this movie that Warner Brothers didn't drop it? Warner Brothers didn't back away from Ezra Miller. Like, what is this movie? And how, because the reports are that the screenings are like through the roof.
Yeah. Like, what is this cinematic gold, right? This is like the Ark of the Covenant. Why does everybody need to see this movie?
If I go to see this movie and it is like, you know, not that much better than Black Adam, I'm gonna be like, really? You like, this is your person that you were backing for this?
This was the hill to die on.
This was the hill. Okay. Yeah. I'm be like, but I just, you know, I've said it on this show before, like before all the trouble, I really enjoyed Ezra Miller's presence on screen in other stuff, and like, you know, across the first time I saw Ezra was in a movie called City Island, which is like a little movie with like Andy Garcia. I think Andy Garcia might have even directed it, and I loved it. I thought like that Ezra was going to be like a big star. I was like, that, yeah, you know, just popped off the screen. And I still like believe in the talent of Ezra Miller. And I hope that they're past everything and that this is the second, you know, the second chance. But if this movie is not good, I'm just going to be baffled by like, why was this the hill? Okay, and so I just have to believe that it will be.
But here's the thing. Let's consider the alternative. What if it's the greatest comic book movie ever?
Exactly.
What then? What then?
How good does this movie have to be? Like, compare it to like another pre-existing like superhero movie. How good does this
movie are have we to comparing be? It to DC movies or comparing it to
any superhero movie period? How good does this movie have to be for everything to have been worth it?
Endgame.
Really? Wow.
For it to have all to for it to have all been worth it, for it to have all been worth it, Endgame. But so for it to at least have been like arguable, you know, like arguable, I would say like, I would put it in First Guardians territory.
So Endgame is like top 10 for me. So like that's a pretty high bar that it.
When you say top 10, you say top 10 comic book movies of all time or top 10 movies of all time? Okay. Okay.
Yeah. Oh, movies of no.
I was wondering. I just wanted to know.
And here's the thing. And when I say Endgame,
MCU movies.
When I say Endgame, I'm not just talking about like the quality of the movie. I'm not talking about the box office either. I'm just talking about like the impact.
The satisfaction. Endgame,
The in-movie feeling of joy that it brings me and has brought to millions of people who watch the movie. Like, it would need to deliver that kind of experience in the cinema for me to say, you know what? It was all worth it. If it ends up reaching First Guardians level, I can at least be like, I get it. DC hasn't had a movie like that in forever. Like... Yeah. They want to at least show that they're still in this thing, you know.
Right.
Yeah, I feel like I might almost be expecting at this point, because of what they're saying about the screenings and everything, mm-hmm. I might almost be expecting it to be as feel good as like, man, it's high praise. I don't know if I can even say it, but like, as good of coming out of the theater as I did when I saw Spider-Verse, basically. It's like,
oh no, that's
see, and that's the thing, that's, is when I saw Spider-Verse, I was like, that's the best superhero movie I've ever seen. So hold on.
Let's fall back on that.
But the thing is, like maybe not in terms of like,
so maybe No Way Home.
Maybe. It's just like I expect to be utterly entertained by this movie in a way that I frankly have not been by any post Dark Knight DC movies, you know, like I've enjoyed some dark, you know, some DC movies. I there are some that I like, but there are none that have like delighted me, and I expect to kind of be delighted. That's what I think I'm getting at. Like, you know, Winter Soldier was a good movie. I wasn't delighted, you know. It was like, oh, that was a good movie. I expect to like be like over the moon for like the way I feel about the Flash franchise coming out of this movie. And I don't know that it can get there, but that's kind of what they're selling at this point.
Yeah. And then it's a weird thing, right? Because, you know, tied into the next story that we're going to tell, we don't really know where it's going to lead. So what happens if it's the greatest thing that they've done in the last 15 years and there are no plans for a sequel?
This movie seems to have like been touted as like Zack Snyder DCEU Endgame, basically, where it wraps up all of
But the thing is, we loved the MCU leading up to Endgame. You know what I mean? Like, how do you wrap up something that is like mid?
This is more a mercy kill than
totally.
I don't know. I think that they're probably going to leave themselves enough thread that they can get back to any of these franchises if they want to via some sort of multiversal event. Right. But also, like, as I was telling, I was at a birthday party today and I was talking comic book movies with somebody, and The Rock came up. They're like, oh, how was that Black Adam movie? And I was like, it wasn't great. And there's like, yeah, and also like, they're not going to make another one. I was like, listen, if Black Adam would have made $1 billion, it would definitely be in the new DC universe. Yeah.
And actually, I just thought about something. No Way Home might be the comp, right? Because if Sony and Marvel had not come to an agreement on future projects. That could have been the last, that could have been the way to say goodbye to that, to that group of actors and that character in the MCU. And it would have been pretty satisfying.
Yep. I'd be totally fine if No Way Home, I know it's not going to be, but if that were it, and for some unforeseen circumstances, they couldn't make any more, I'd be happy with No Way Home being the last.
Yeah. So maybe that's, maybe that's the bar. Maybe that's the comp, that that the Flash, I'll try to work my way through to a pun somewhere. No Flash Home, or, you know, but if it can hit that level of the combination of the multiversal feel good ending on a positive note, that, you know, that leaves people in the theater feeling like cinema has returned. I suppose in a lot of ways it will have been worth it. But high bar for DC. Speaking of Flash and things that may be worth it, the CW is running towards the final season of The Flash and their finale. And wouldn't you know it, pretty much everybody's coming back. It's a reunion time. David Ramsey, Keenan Lonsdale, Stephen Amell. I think some of the people from Supergirl as well. Basically, everybody who's everybody in the Arrowverse, or the Flarrowverse, as they tried to make a thing for briefly. Coming back for the final season, for the finale, to say goodbye to superhero movies on the superhero shows on the CW, and happy for them, happy that they're gonna get a send off.
Arrowverse Endgame.
Yeah,
and it is, in the sense, you know, that there are two kinds of final seasons. There are, maybe there are three. There's the one where you're like, oh, that got canceled. They definitely. Right. And then there's the, this should have been gone 2 years ago. Mm-hmm. And then there's the take a victory lap. And I think this is that. This is setting up to be, even the posters for the final season. Like, there's one of Barry running down that same road that I think the first poster's from, but like lining both sides of the streets are all of the posters from the previous seasons. It's really good. It's a really good poster, especially for a TV show. Mm-hmm. I like the idea that this is like the Flash's victory lap, because that's a very successful TV show. Like, you stayed on for a long time.
And lest we not forget that the same, in the same time frame that one Flash was being cast for the movies, another Flash was being cast for the show. And they had a whole season, a whole 9 seasons of show that will be airing before that movie comes out in the theaters. So shout out to long production cycles. Staying in the realm of DC, but moving to a different medium, we're going to talk about a little podcast on Spotify, starring Harley Quinn and the Joker.
Ooh.
Yes. Weirdly enough, they're going to drop all the episodes at once on Spotify. 7 episode series. So someone's getting those media points. Harley Quinn and the Joker audio series. Called Sound Mind, with Christina Ricci playing Harley, Billy Magnussen, who I've definitely seen his name before.
He's
the Joker. And who else is going to be? Justin Hartley is going to voice Bruce Wayne. Amy Sedaris is going to be involved. Andre Royo, who you might know from The Bubbles. Wire. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Arnold Wesker, Stephen Root. Who else? Fred Malamed, who I'm not familiar with. Mary Holland. So yeah, there's, you know, star-studded cast. Spotify, January 31st, 2023. So we're just a couple weeks away.
Do we know what this is? Like, what the story is? Do they?
I believe it's a bit of an origin story.
Damn it. Okay.
Yeah, a bit of a Harley. You know, you're hoping for punchline involvement.
No, what I'm so a buddy and I, 3-4 years ago, were like, you know, we should write like a podcast of just like the recording sessions of Harley Quinn interviewing, you know, the sessions with the Joker at Arkham. And it, I have a feeling that's what we're going to get.
Yeah. I mean, it does seem like I remember listening to the trailer. It seems like one of those things where it starts out as she's psychoanalyzing the Joker, but he starts to turn the table.
Yes. Yes. On her. I'm familiar with the concept. I almost wrote it. Damn it.
And then by the end, he convinces her to become a criminal. Mm-hmm. So that's cool. I've been falling down the rabbit hole of these comic book audio series. So I haven't listened to the Batman one, the Unburied.
It's a good one.
But I heard it's really good.
Yeah.
You know, eventually I'll revisit that. But I've been listening to maybe I'll listen to that before the Harley one. But I've listened to the Marvel ones and I like the Marvel ones. They're good. So yeah.
I've listened to the Batman I think it's Unburied, I think is the
I think so.
And then it's like a Wolverine one, the Marvel one.
Yeah, that's the
there's two Wolverine ones. I've listened to the first Wolverine one. Yeah.
Yeah.
Wasteland or
Wastelanders, but then I think there's a regular Wolverine one.
Yeah. Like the regular Wolverine one is really good.
Well, especially because the guy who voices that is also a writer. And I didn't know that until I saw him at Comic-Con and heard his voice. And I was like, this guy's got a voice for radio. Why is he wasting his time doing comics?
The Long Night. That's what it's called. The Long Night. Yeah.
And it's going to bother me, so I'm going to look it up. And he's also
Richard Armitage.
No, not the guy who's voicing Wolverine. The guy behind the podcast who's also writing Wolverine right now.
Oh, I see.
So my guess is he's probably like narrating. This is bad radio, guys.
Benjamin Percy?
Yes, Benjamin Percy.
Thank you. Who looks like Wolverine, honestly.
Yeah, and again, he's currently writing the Wolverine book, which has been very good.
Okay.
He also wrote a very good run on Green Arrow, which is one of my favorites
Recent
memory. But yeah, but he's got a great radio voice. If I had his voice, I would be doing more podcasting.
Yeah, no, The Long Night was like, oh, this is great. This is really good. And then I tried to listen to the Squirrel Girl podcast, which it was like, I don't know. It was
little set up quirky. As
like, yeah, did you listen to it? It was set up as like a college radio show.
Okay.
And I'm sure it was going to get to something at some point, but like, I didn't have the patience for it for whatever reason. I was like, I gave it, you know, however long, half an hour. I was like, yeah, I think I might be done. Mm-hmm. I'll go back to it. I think Damon has from the White Delegation, Damon has confirmed that it's good, but I haven't gone back to it.
All right. Well, listeners, check it out and let us know what you think. Email us at the racial draft pod. No, the racial draft podcast at gmail.com.
Take out the just racial draft
podcast. Racial draft podcast. Right. staying in the Batman realm, though, there was a little bit of conversation around Matt Reeves and his Batman verse. Speaking of Vuz. He said he's going to have some discussions with James Gunn and Peter Safran about making sure that his universe doesn't crash into the DC universe, cinematic universe that's coming. Again, a little disappointed because I'd love for those universes to crash together at some point, but I get it. We could probably have a whole podcast on our fantasy booking of the Batman verse, and maybe we will at some point, but not now.
Yeah, I don't know that Matt Reeves's Batman universe, the same way I didn't feel that Chris Nolan's Batman universe really lent itself to less grounded superhero stuff.
I think as a prequel it could work.
Okay. Yeah, I don't know. The thing, as we've all learned on this show, Batman is almost a universe unto himself. And
for sure.
And so like it's like maybe the one superhero that never needs to touch another universe, and you could just live in it forever.
Yeah, but
X-Men probably would be the other one.
But the thing is, you have to commit to all the other connected characters, which eventually those characters are going to interact with other people. That's why, you know, that's why it's almost a catch-22. If you just do Batman, you know, Batman, and characters kind of interact, like enter into Gotham and then go away, like that's one thing. But all the other characters have, you know, the Suicide Squad. There are a lot of Batman villains in the Suicide Squad.
Right.
You know, the Teen Titans. There are former Robins in the Teen Titans.
Right.
You know, Bane, you know, has interactions with other people in other universes. You know what I mean? Like, so unless you're going to commit to having two of everything, which they don't really want to do that, unless it's the Joker, then they'll have three of him. They don't care.
Well, that's what I'm that's what I'm saying, is if they're not going to connect the Joaquin Phoenix Joker movies, then why do they necessarily have to connect the Batman movies to anything either?
Because the Joker movies are a fever dream. That's the answer.
I'm kind of in the same boat as Carlos here. I feel like audiences have an appetite for Batman, and the market can sustain two different Batmans.
Well, here's the thing. When you say the market can sustain two Batman or whatever, I think yes and no, because I think that we've only had one, like, Batman. Like, the Batman. Like, you know, not to talk about the movie too much, but like at one point, at one time, you know, it's not like we had two ongoing Batman franchises at once. Yeah. Is what
So that's what I was getting at. I guess this Batman is really positioned, the Matt Reeves Battinson. Like, he's definitely more so positioned to where James Gunn seems to want to start his new universe. But the only problem is, instead of, like, with, if Gunn were to integrate that, the Matt Reeves's vision into his own, Reeves doesn't seem to want to explore characters like Robin or, you're just missing out if you don't. Yeah. Incorporate Robin and other characters.
Yeah. But while I agree 100% with what you're saying, I think it, going back to the question of whether the market can sustain multiple Batman, mm-hmm. let's say tomorrow, James Gunn makes an announcement, you know, hey, we also have a Batman in our universe, and he's going to be played by Actor X.
Yeah.
Jewish Batman. I think that Actor X is in a position where he's either going to be constantly compared to the Pattinson Batman, right, and have to deal with concerns that he will be the inferior Batman.
Yeah.
That's one door, you know, to walk down. And then I think the other door would be, what if he is actually awesome? And now Matt Reeves is pissed, because there's this new awesome Batman that now people don't care as much about Pattinson Batman. You know, I think that inherently, like, Batman's one of those characters that you got to figure out who your A Batman is, and who your B Batman is. And you got to, everyone has to be on board with, yeah, I'm the B Batman. I'm not the, you know, I think that when we thought that Michael Keaton was going to be the, like, grizzled retired Batman that was too old for it and just kind of hanging back, mm-hmm. I think that was more tolerable, even when Ben Affleck was going to do that, you know, because he was just basically going to be like, yeah, I had a couple movies as Batman, but now I'm just gonna let other people cook, mm-hmm. in the Batman world.
Yeah,
but
Batman Incorporated.
Yeah, but to introduce a brand new person to be Batman while we're already kind of learning and getting deeper and more emotionally attached to the Pattinson Batman, that's the part where I'm a little bit wary.
Right.
You know, But we shall see. You know, maybe we won't get Batman for a few years. I doubt it.
Right. That could, well, you know what? I don't know. What if the plan is like, hey, make your three Batman movies.
Mm-hmm.
We can build out this DC universe, mm-hmm, with our new Superman and our new Wonder Woman and our Green Lanterns and all of that. And then when you're done making your, you know, film these two back to back, make them, get them out of the way, get your Penguin TV show done. But like 6 years or 5 years from now, you're done. And we're going to introduce our Gunverse Batman.
Oh, I see. I thought you were going to say, and then we're going to pluck Pattinson and put him into the Gunverse.
I just think that by that point, Pattinson's what, 45 years old? Like,
yeah, but then by that time, the checks will be massive that he would be willing to, you know.
Well, that's the other thing. If those movies make billions, then okay.
Yeah.
Guess what?
Yeah, we're backing up the Brinks truck. We're bringing the Pattinson Batman into the Gunverse. And yeah, he's just 45. That's all right.
What if they back up the Brinks truck and Christian Bale is the Batman in the Gunverse?
Ooh. Ooh.
What if that happened?
Well, then everybody just starts calling Pattinson Batman B.
we call him Batman Zero, and Christian Bale's Batman Classic.
Yeah, pretty much. It's like you've been supplanted.
Yeah.
I feel like this is a whole side conversation. Like, even though Keaton is first in our hearts, in a lot of people's hearts, we can accept Keaton as like grizzled old Batman. Even though Bale is older, it'll just feel like he's coming back to take his crown back.
Yeah. Okay. All right. So the answer is George Clooney. Got it.
Oh, yeah. If George Clooney came back, then we're like, oh, wow, washed Batman. You're definitely washed Batman.
Yeah.
Nobody likes you.
You're kind of fat now.
Like, all right. So here's a question. What if the reason everybody likes The Flash is because George Clooney's in it?
Yeah, maybe.
I'm putting it out there. I want to be the first one on record to say George Clooney is in The Flash. And that's
what if
it.
What if the Batman of the Gunverse is Joseph Gordon-Levitt from The Dark Knight Rises?
Is he Bruce Wayne or is he?
No, he's that Robin. He's the...
Ooh, then I don't like it.
Come
then
on.
I don't like it. If he's just Jordan, if he's still Bruce Wayne, but he's just played by Joseph Gordon-Levitt, then I love it, you know?
Oh, yeah. I mean...
Because then it's just like stunt casting, you know? Mm-hmm. It's like, you remember? Yeah.
Bruce Boner.
but if it's that same character whose name escapes me right now, who...
I know his real name is Robin. That's all. Ooh.
Was it James Blake?
Was it Blake or Drake?
I think it was Blake. I think it's Blake.
Blake.
Was it John Blake? James Blake?
It probably was John Blake. Yeah.
Yeah. John Robin Blake.
I actually think it's Robin John Blake, right? I think that's...
Yeah. That's
he goes by his middle name.
Yeah. Sure. Yeah. So if it's Joseph Gordon-Levitt, but he's still Bruce Wayne, then I'm really into it, actually, because Joseph Gordon-Levitt's grown into like a Bruce Wayne character. Then you get Rian Johnson to direct the movie, and then we've gone full circle.
Thank you, Rian Johnson.
Yeah, that would just be points for me. Joseph Gordon-Levitt Batman.
Yeah. You're right. It should be someone Latino.
Yeah, let's just jump ahead. Let's jump into season 6 of the racial draft, where Joseph Gordon-Levitt is. Actually, wait, have you cast the Jewish Batman yet?
No, I've said who it would be, but
you said John Bernthal, didn't you just say?
John Bernthal would probably be my pick unless I can come up with a better one.
Except that John Bernthal is always like, he always plays he would be the character that you cast to like play against Batman to be like,
yeah,
like he's the Punisher. He's
exactly.
He's got to be like, you know, you can't help him, Rick.
That's totally
can't protect him, Rick.
Or he's Wayne Jenkins. You know, imagine
he's.
I just think of Wayne Jenkins in Gotham City. He's the most corrupt cop of all
time.
That
would be amazing.
I now want John Bernthal in the Batman as Wayne Jenkins. Bruce like Wayne Jenkins.
John Bernthal, like, you know, 15 years ago would have been like Red Hood. You know what I'm saying? Like, yeah, he would have been like, sure. I'm Batman, but I kill.
I mean, you could have him play Vigilante if you wanted to, like, really go that.
John Bernthal Deathstroke would be
interesting.
That would be better than
John Bernthal Batman.
Yeah. Yes. But no, better than I forgot who played him in this
thing. Joe Manganiello.
Joe. Yeah. Yes.
Yeah.
Come on.
I don't know. He's all right.
He's all right. He's all right.
One post credit scene. I can't judge.
I mean, personally, I think his energy as an actor would be a better fit for like Marvel, you know.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. He kind of has a little bit of charisma and comedy. Flash Thompson. Yeah, and that's not something I usually associate with Deathstroke.
My wife and I to this day do that thing that he does as Flash Thompson in the first Spider-Man, where he makes a W and goes, "Whatever."
Oh man.
He could work actually as, if they're going to recast Shazam, he could be a solid Shazam.
He actually would be a solid. Though. But he's the kind of old where like you're like, oh, he looked good for his age, you know?
Yeah, yeah.
When I was in Paris, he was also there with Sofia Vergara, and mm-hmm. they were like, anywhere we were, they would post on Instagram that they were there yesterday. I was like, damn it. We would go to the Louvre. They were at the Louvre yesterday. We went to like whatever cathedral. They were at the cathedral yesterday.
Yeah. But yeah, Joe Manganiello as Shazam is more, I'd say that's more inspired than Joe Manganiello as Deathstroke for sure.
Mm. Definitely more inspired.
Yeah. But that's it. That's our nerd news. We went a little bit longer than we thought, but that's all right. We're going to come back off our break, and then we're going to get deep into the racial draft business.